time for my traditional talk with Mark van der Gijs when he's in Holland. Hey, first you you drove the Tesla Model 3, and you decided to stay with your Mercedes, another movie, but you just came back from China. How much electric cars did you see there?
A lot, actually, especially in the big cities like Beijing and Shanghai. I don't know the percentage, but you see a lot more cars than you do see here, especially the smaller cars, the middle-class cars, not necessarily the high-end ones like the Tesla. But
BYD, the Build Your Dream.
Correct. Yeah, the BYD is a big one, obviously. There's a lot of others as well. And the nice thing is, in China, the electric cars have a different license plate. So they have a greenish license plate, so you see right away that it's an electric car. And that's maybe also why you see more of them, because you notice them more easily.
Yeah. Also, in Shanghai, you have to have a lottery to basically get a number plate, and it's 20,000 euro, and if an electric one is for free. So that also is one hell of an incentive to basically get it there. Talk about, you lived in China for a while, you are now living in Vancouver, but your kids live in your kids live in China again. How did Chinese society change in the last 5-6 years?
Well, society is more China focused, I would say. I mean, when I lived there, foreigners were put on a pedestal. A lot of people looked up to you in a way.
Everybody learned English.
Yeah, well, that's still the case actually. People still learn English, but it's. I think, you know, China is more of a they're more self-centered in a way. They feel stronger. They are a much stronger society. The economy is much stronger, and you know they're very confident about themselves more than before, which is a good thing, I would say. But it's, you know, it's you really feel it's a different lifestyle for expats and non-Chinese.
It's not that the whole country is working for the West. They have an internal economy and they have an internal consumption, which is really quite good, huh?
It is. I mean, you know, the biggest companies in the world are Chinese companies or will be Chinese companies. Many people don't know about these companies yet, but they are important, and they probably will win in the future, I think.
Yeah. So you also saw that there is an the government basically went from export more to internal consumption. You talked about a tropical island where you went, which changed completely.
Yeah, so I was in Hainan a couple of days ago. Hainan is in the south of China. It's basically the Hawaii of China. And it's actually an island where I produced the first Chinese reality TV show back in 2003. And at that time, it was an unspoiled island. Beautiful beaches, beautiful coconut plantations. You know, not many people. Yeah. And I hadn't been back in many years, actually. And I landed there, and I was flabbergasted. I mean, super highways, just, you know, all over the island. The whole beachfront completely developed. You know, apartment buildings everywhere, big resorts, 5-star hotels.
People are taking vacations.
Yeah, I mean, it's logical, right? I mean, China has 1.3, 1.4 billion people, and you know, they go on vacation, and most don't have passports. So Hainan's the only tropical islands in China. So yeah, that's where you end up. Yeah.
If you look at the confidence, you say there's more confidence of the Chinese in themselves. They're not looking up to the Westerners anymore. What about this world, this trade war? Does it worry them, or does it also make them more feeling independent?
Well, I mean, I think they still realize that they still need the U.S. in a way. So yeah, they have to sort of, you know, make sure that it doesn't go too far. But I know they're quite confident that it's a matter of time. In a few more years, China will be much stronger than they currently are. And I think the U.S. will be a lot weaker given what's happening there. So yeah, China is going to be the new world leader, I think. And they know
and feel that.
Oh yeah, for sure. No. I wouldn't say they look down on the U.S. necessarily, but, you know, the respect is certainly gone. So, yeah.
They don't look down on the America, but the respect is gone. What about Europe? What role do we play here?
I mean, it's an interesting export market, I would say, for China, but I don't hear too much about it, to be honest. So it's. I mean, the most discussions are really about North America and China, and that's partly because I live in North America. So that's also the topic for me mainly. I mean, Canada is in a very bad position right now. China and Canada, diplomatic relations are not great at all.
Is it because of the arrest of Huawei CFO?
Yeah, the Huawei CFO. She was arrested in Vancouver and is still under house arrest there. I think it was a very stupid decision from Canada, but okay, they made that decision. And
just to please the neighbor.
Yeah, but it's gonna hurt Canada a lot more than America. So, yeah.
Okay. So that is basically. What do you think about the government? How is the government developing in China?
Well, I mean, on the one hand, I think, you know, Xi Jinping is getting much stronger. He's really, he's really going to be a leader for life, the way it looks right now. He's pretty smart in the way he does his propaganda. He's using an app for that, for example, that, you know, with you know, gamification in there, with getting as many points as
app,
possible.
You need a fantastic app to get all the Chinese propaganda in a very smart way.
Yeah, I mean, you know, so he sort of forced people to use that app. It's a smart way, because most people don't really understand its propaganda, I think, and they maybe like the gamification, I don't know. So, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, having a leader for life is not necessarily a good thing. But then again, you know, China...
How smart is he?
He's a very smart guy. Yeah. He's a very smart guy. I mean, compared to all the world leaders, I think he's probably one of the smartest out there. It's... And you know,
and he thinks 50 years ahead. If you look at the new route, he's buying all these harbors, and he's having that new Silk route.
Yeah, but I mean, China has always been doing this, right? It's China, you know, basically since the opening up in the late 70s, early 80s, China has been thinking, you know, 30, 40 years in advance. So the things that are happening right now, they thought about it in the 80s. You know, look at what China has done in Africa. They're basically dominating Africa right now by investing there and giving loans and basically taking control of it. Mm-hmm. They're doing the same now with the Belt and what is it called, Belt and Roads Initiative. And you know, the next thing is they're working on things like climate change. People don't see that, but they're taking a leading role there. When I lived in China, in when I left in 2013, one reason was the air pollution.
It's changing, huh?
It's changing a lot. I mean, you know,
it's getting better.
I've been in China 3-4 times this year already, and I haven't really seen a lot of pollution. Maybe one or two days that was pretty bad, but it's not that there's no constant pollution. It's, you know, so it's changing fast in a very positive way. So, you know, it's China is certainly not only good, but it's getting a lot better. Yeah.
And is the government, how is the government appreciated? If you talk to normal business people, they're not too bothered about how they can operate there.
I don't think people are bothered by it. I mean, it's more consistent generally than it is in the U.S. I mean, if I talk to U.S. business people, they're actually worried about what's happening with Trump and the fighting between the Republicans and Democrats. Nobody knows what's going to happen, really. You can't really build on this. China, at least, you have a general sense of what could happen. And of course, there are sudden changes there as well, sudden changes in laws in China that are unexpected. But in general, you know what's going to happen to society, and you can't prepare for it. So I think, you know,
if you don't bother the government too much, you can basically do your own thing.
Well, it depends. I mean, you shouldn't bother the government for sure. But you cannot necessarily just do your own thing. You have to do things that are in line with policies for sure. But yeah, I mean, there's a lot of freedom in China. It's a capitalist country basically. You can invest money, you can make money. That's appreciated by everyone, even by the communist government. So, yeah,
but Western people do not appreciate that you can have a lot of freedom in being entrepreneurial, but you cannot use YouTube or Facebook or Twitter or whatever. Everything is monitored, everything is controlled. But you still, within that control, you have a lot of freedom.
I think you have very similar amount of freedom as you have in the US. I mean, in the US, Facebook and Google know exactly what you're doing. They also collect all data on you, but it's just not something that people really think about that much. It's getting more now. In China, the government's collecting information. Question is, do they use it for something? I don't think so. If they need to do it for something, need to use it, they can use it, but in general, they don't really use it. And people realize that collecting data will give China the leading edge in artificial intelligence, because the main reason why a country will win AI is not by investing a lot in it, but by having the right data sets for it. And that's what China has.
Okay, so positive over China in the next 5 or 10 years? Good place for your kids to grow up?
It's good for them to live there for a few years. I don't think they'll grow up there for the rest of their youth. But it's good for 2-3 years to understand for them what China is all about, to learn fluent Chinese. I think it's good for them. I think it's good. I mean, China's getting stronger, and you know, I think, you know, people dismiss China for some reason, and it's mainly, I think, because they don't really understand the country. Many people haven't been there. They listen, you know, they read the newspapers that are still sort of dismissive about it, negative about China. I think that is a mistake. China is actually is doing very well and will do a lot better.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm going on. I'm going next September. I'm going to organize a trip about electric driving to China. Very interesting place. They do now 2 times as much CO2 as the Americans. So it's 30% of all the CO2 instead of America 15%. They went down. China is going up. But they also work extremely hard on green energy, electric convergence. So we'll see how it works. So this gives you a head up. China is going to be the most powerful nation. You can feel it. They can feel it themselves. They are more convinced about themselves. Really interesting. Thanks. Next interview is about crypto. Oh.